this is the 23rd lecture of this course and the 5th lecture on the topic of PN junctions. In the previous lecture, what we have done is that we have derived an equation for the ideal forward diode characteristics, that is this equation. Now, this equation was derived in the following steps. When you apply a forward bias of V volts, we assume that the entire bias is appearing across the depletion layer. The depletion layer shrinks as compared to the equilibrium condition. And then what happens is that the positive terminal injects holes into the N region and the negative terminal injects electrons into the P region. The negative terminal also injects electrons to provide for recombination of holes which are injected from the P region, and the positive terminal injects holes which supply the recombination associated with the electrons which are injected from the N region. So this is the flow diagram showing the movement of holes and electrons. Next, we showed that the concentration of excess carriers at the depletion edge can be obtained using the quasi-equilibrium approximation and applying this approximation to the Boltzmann relation, and the result is that the excess hole concentration at the depletion edge on the N side is given by PN0, that is equilibrium hole concentration, multiplied by exponential V by Vt minus 1. And a similar relation applies for excess electrons on the depletion edge on the P side. Then, by using the diffusion approximation for minority carriers, we showed that the minority carrier concentration, the excess minority carrier concentration, can be assumed to decay exponentially in the quasi-neutral regions. So this is the exponential decay and this is the other exponential decay in the N and P regions. Then we said that based on these excess carrier concentrations, we can sketch the hole current for the N region and the electron current for the P region, because this is based on diffusion approximations. To get the total current, we need to know the electron current and hole current both at any one point. This is because under steady state conditions, the J is a constant with X. Now, to get the electron and hole currents at any point, what we have done is that we have assumed that in the depletion layer, the hole currents and electron currents remain constant, that is, there is no recombination in the depletion layer. Once we assume that, then we can extend this electron current from this depletion edge to the other depletion edge, and we can extend the hole current from this depletion edge to the other depletion edge here. And once we do that, now we have both electron and hole currents at points within the depletion layer, and therefore we can use this and obtain this particular relation. Now let us write this relation in a compact form. So first step is to recognize that the current I can be written by multiplying this equation by the area. So we multiply this by area and change the left hand side from J to I. Now we can recognize that this whole term is a constant that we will represent by the symbol I suffix 0. And we obtain the ideal diode characteristics I equal to I naught exponential v by vt minus 1. So this is the well-known diode equation. Now notice that we have derived this for forward bias. We will be doing a similar exercise for reverse bias a little later. Now let us understand what we should do to complete this picture for electron current on this side and the hole current here. And what information do we derive from this? So since we know the total current J, we can get the electron current as total current minus the hole current. So hole current is known. So from there, we can get information about the electron current. So this electron current is simply this constant line minus this line. And similarly, we can get the hole current on this side as this total current minus this electron current. So that completes the current density as a function of x. Now, what are the mechanisms of current flow involved here? Let us look at these a little more closely. Now, this Jp is because of diffusion, because this is the current of minority carriers. So this we can say is Jp diffusion. Similarly, this current is again because of diffusion, because these are electrons in the p region. So this is Jn diffusion. Now what about the hole current here? This is the hole current. Now clearly, the hole current cannot be because of diffusion, because if you assume the hole current to be because of diffusion, then the direction of the current will be opposite to the direction of flow that we have shown here. This is because excess holes are equal in concentration to excess electrons. And since excess electron concentration is like this, the excess hole concentration also would be given by a similar function. So this kind of a shape indicates the flow of carriers in this direction because of diffusion. Now this means if this is the concentration of excess holes, then the holes will move in this direction, which is opposite to the direction that is shown here. So evidently the hole current is in p region is not because of diffusion. Similar comments apply to the electron current, this particular current in the n region. So majority carrier currents cannot be because of diffusion. This is very clear from this analysis. So which means that the majority carrier currents have to be flowing because of drift. So, and this is quite logical, because when you are applying a voltage like this, small electric fields would be present in the neutral regions, which we have neglected. And these electric fields cause the voltage drops in P region and N region. So these small electric fields are sufficient to provide the required hole current in this direction, and the electron current also in this direction. What is shown here is the flow of electrons, not the electron current, because the electrons, for the electrons, the current is in the opposite direction to the direction of their flow. Now, returning to this diagram here, we can say that this represents the hole current because of drift, and this is much greater than the diffusion current of holes for majority carriers. So this is mostly the drift current. Similarly, this is also the drift current of electrons. So Jn drift, this is much greater than Jn diffusion. So the picture is as following. This terminal injects electrons. These electrons move by drift and they provide for recombination with the holes which are injected from P region. Then electrons come to the edge and they get injected to the P side. We have neglected the recombination of electrons during their transit in the depletion layer. Now, and then these electrons then move by diffusion because they are minority carriers here. And as they diffuse, they recombine. Similar arguments apply for holes. The positive terminal injects holes. These holes move by drift in this direction, and during the drift, they also recombine since they provide for recombination with the electrons which are injected from the N side. Then they get injected at this depletion edge onto the other side. Since we are neglecting the recombination in the depletion layer, the holes are shown to simply move without any recombination to this edge. Then as they get injected in the N region, they move by diffusion because they are minority carriers in the N region, and as they diffuse, they recombine. So that is the picture of the electron and hole flow within the p-n junction. Now let us do a salt example. So explain important features of these observed forward current voltage characteristics based on the ideal diode theory. The important things that we will try to explain on this slide is how the current of about 1 milliampere can be accounted for at 0.6 volts and how beyond this point, within a very small voltage range, the current rises very rapidly. Okay, so you can see that the current rises from 1 milliampere to 10 milliamperes within a few tenths of millivolts. That is what is seen here. Okay, so let us try to explain this particular feature. Now, this is the equation, I equal to I naught exponential V by Vt minus 1. Now we have in our observed characteristics, this I is 1 milliampere and this V is 600 millivolts. Let us see, this means how much I naught is there. Let us try to evaluate I naught, which accounts for this. Now Vt is 0.026 volts or 26 millivolts, because we are considering room temperature. So if you substitute these values, we get I naught as 0.026 is equal to I upon exponential V by Vt minus 1, which is equal to 1 milliampere divided by exponential of 600 by 26 minus 1. And if you evaluate this value, you will get this is equal to 9.5 into 10 power minus 14 amperes. So this is the value of I naught. So this means that for real silicon diodes, the current I naught is of the order of 10 power minus 13 amperes, so which is 1/10 of a picoampere. Okay, so that is the order, 1/10 of a picoampere of I naught. Now let us see, if you want to increase the current from 1 milliampere to 10 milliampere, what should be the change in voltage? So for this purpose, we will write this equation in terms of I1 by I2. So I1 upon I2 is equal to exponential of v1 by vt minus 1 by exponential of v2 by vt minus 1. Now, we have seen that this v1 is much more than vt and v2 is also much more than vt in the forward direction for the currents I1 and I2 involved. Therefore, we can neglect this one. And from here, we obtain v1 minus v2 is equal to vt into ln I1 upon I2. So, if you want the difference in voltage for a change in current by 10 times, then we can write I1 equal to 10 times I2, and therefore your v1 minus v2 will be equal to this delta V will be equal to Vt ln 10, which is of the order of 60 millivolts. Okay. So within 60 millivolts change in voltage, you will get a factor of 10 change in current. So that is why on this diagram, the current changes from 1 milliampere here to 10 milliamperes here within an interval of about 60 millivolts. So we will show this clearly here. So suppose this is 1 milliampere and this is 10 milliamperes. This difference is about 60 millivolts. Now, it is of interest to know what will be the voltage, the cut-in voltage for a diode made in a different material such as gallium arsenide. Please note that the cut-in voltage is this voltage here, which was 0.6 volts in our graph here. So this is the 0.6 volts point. This is the cut-in voltage. So to see how the cut-in voltage depends on the material parameters, we will rewrite this equation. So this is equal to A into Q. This NP0 and PN0 we will write in terms of the minority carrier concentration, in terms of the Ni square product as Ni square divided by doping level. So this dN by ln Na plus dP by LP and D into exponential of V by Vt minus 1. And further, we will write this Ni square as Nc Nv into exponential of minus psi g by Vt, where psi g is the energy gap. Now, we will make some assumptions to simplify this whole thing. One thing is that since it is a P plus N junction, the Na is much more than Nd. So we will neglect this term. And then since we are considering forward bias, and for V greater than 3 times Vt, exponential of V by Vt is much greater than 1. So we will neglect this one also. And then we will get a simple equation, and that is A into Q into Nc Nv upon Nd into dP upon LP into exponential of V minus psi g upon Vt. So here we are getting the equation in terms of all material parameters. This is the energy gap of the material with which the diode is made. Now we can identify this whole term as a current that we will call I1 to distinguish it from I0. So when we use this symbolism, we will get a simplified equation as I1 exponential of V minus psi g upon Vt. So this is a form of the equation. From here, we can clearly see what is the difference in the voltage for two different diodes for a given current I. So we can rewrite this equation as V is equal to psi g plus Vt ln I by I1. Now notice here that this I1 is a large current. So the current I is of the order of milliamperes, and I leave it as an exercise. You substitute the values here and you will find I1 will be of the order of amperes, of the order of amperes. If this is milliamperes, it will be in fact about hundreds of amperes, and therefore this is actually a negative quantity. So it may be useful to rewrite this as minus I1 by I. Now we can compare two diodes. For any given I, a gallium arsenide diode voltage minus the silicon diode voltage would be equal to the difference in the energy gaps plus Vt into ln I1 of silicon diode by I2 of gallium arsenide diode. So the difference in cut-in voltages of gallium arsenide and silicon diodes will be equal to difference in energy gap of silicon and gallium arsenide plus a quantity that depends on these currents, which are sensitive to processing and material parameters. Now, gallium arsenide energy gap is 1.43. This is 1.43 electron volts, or in energy, but in terms of volts, it is 1.43 volts, and this is 1.1 volts, and therefore this difference is 0.33 volts. So 0.33 plus Vt ln I1 silicon by I1 of gallium arsenide. So the difference in cut-in voltages would be more than 0.33 volts. So this is silicon characteristics and this is gallium arsenide characteristics, diode characteristics. This is about 0.6. This will be more than about a volt, because 0.6 plus 0.33 plus a voltage, so about a volt. Let us see this clearly on this graph. So this is the cut-in voltage for the silicon diodes, and this is the characteristics for the gallium arsenide diode, on which you see the cut-in voltage. More than about 1. So this difference is about 0.45 or so between the silicon cut-in voltage and the gallium arsenide diode cut-in voltage. Now, a few more words about the cut-in voltage. Many times students think that the cut-in voltage represents the built-in voltage of the p-n junction. This is wrong. So we need to understand the cut-in voltage and built-in voltage both properly. The cut-in voltage is the voltage obtained by linearly extrapolating the current voltage curve to the voltage axis in the range in which the currents are shown on the graph. So for example, if you take the current voltage characteristics shown on scale of 0 to 10 milliamperes, which is what we have done in the slide. So here we are plotting the current on a linear axis. This is very important. The cut-in voltage concept can only be understood with reference to a current voltage characteristics plotted such that the current is on a linear scale and the voltage is also on a linear scale. So when you plot on a linear scale, now let us say the range is 0 to 10 milliamperes, then your characteristics will look something like this. You extrapolate this region, you approximate it by a straight line and then extrapolate it here. This is the cut-in voltage. Now this cut-in voltage is dependent on the currents which are being considered on the characteristics. Okay? So for example, if I were to draw the current voltage characteristics in the range 0 to 10 microamperes instead of milliamperes, okay, then your characteristics will look something like this. So this scale is 0 to 10 microamperes for this curve, and the same scale, okay, is 0 to 10 milliamperes for this particular curve. Now you find that your linearly extrapolated voltage here is much lower than this voltage. Okay? So the cut-in voltage will depend on the range of currents that you are considering. In fact, more specifically, it is not exactly the range of currents, but the range of currents for a diode of particular area. Okay? So for example, for small signal devices, the diodes have a certain area, and the currents that are used are 0 to 10 milliamperes range. So for diodes of small signal applications, the currents of 0 to 10 milliamperes area for that particular 0 to 10 milliamperes current for that particular area, this cut-in voltage of 0.6 volts is appropriate. Now if you were to go for lower currents using the same diode, you will have to use a lower cut-in voltage. Okay? So you may even use cut-in voltages of 0.4 volts, for example, if for the diode of that particular area your currents are lower. Okay? And on the other hand, if your currents are higher than 10 milliamperes and you are in going to amperes range, you will use a higher cut-in voltage. So the cut-in voltage is very sensitive to the current range that you are considering in the particular application. It is not a constant for a diode, okay, independent of the current range. And also, another thing to note is this cut-in voltage concept can only be understood with reference to a current voltage characteristics plotted with current on the linear axis. Okay? Now the fact that the cut-in voltage would be lower if you take 0 to 10 microamperes instead of 10 milliamperes can easily be seen by looking at the current voltage characteristics plotted on the log scale, which shows the currents over a very wide range. So you can see it here. The log scale is important to show characteristics over a wide current range. Now supposing I were to take this 0 to 10 microamperes range, then the cut-in voltage here may correspond to current of approximately somewhere around 1 microampere. Okay? So this current here may be a microampere, suppose. Exactly it may be a little bit different, but let's assume that approximately is 1 microampere here. Okay? 1/10 of this current, that is what I mean. About 1/10. So this extrapolated voltage may correspond to this current. Now you see that if you take a current of, for example, 1 microampere here, that would be somewhere here, because this is milliampere axis. This is about 10 power minus 3 milliampere, so 1 microampere. For a silicon diode, you are here. So this is the cut-in voltage. You can see that this is little more than 0.4, maybe about 0.45. Okay? On the other hand, in the 0 to 10 milliampere scale, you are here, you are operating here. Then the cut-in voltage corresponds to the current of about 1 milliampere, that is here, right? So you can see the difference between this cut-in voltage and the cut-in voltage corresponding to diodes operated in the microamperes range. Okay? So much about the cut-in voltage. Now about the built-in voltage. Okay? The built-in voltage is represented here by the potential versus distance curve for a p-n junction over which no bias is applied. Please understand that this device is under equilibrium. So this is psi versus x, potential versus distance, and here this difference in the potentials on the two sides is psi naught, that is the built-in potential. Now the potential versus x is normally inverse of the electronic potential versus distance, which is shown on the energy band diagram, because this is electronic energies. So potential corresponding to negative charges is what is shown here. Whereas normally by convention, the potential psi corresponds to positive charges. Okay? So this built-in voltage on the energy band diagram will be shown as shown here on a potential versus distance graph. Okay. Now, this built-in voltage is not a measurable quantity. Please note, it is very difficult to measure this quantity because this is equilibrium condition. So under equilibrium conditions, supposing you connect a voltmeter here, you will not read any voltage. So you should not think that this built-in voltage is a measurable voltage, whereas this cut-in voltage is a measurable voltage. You can measure it, because you are measuring a current voltage characteristics under forward bias. You can see, plot these characteristics and get this cut-in voltage. Okay, it will correspond to some measurable point on this curve here. The reason why the built-in voltage which appears under equilibrium conditions cannot be measured is because if this voltmeter was able to measure this voltage, then it means that the diode was pumping some current through the voltmeter, because otherwise the voltmeter cannot measure. And that would mean that the diode is delivering energy to the voltmeter. Okay? Even though there is no source of energy to the diode itself, it is under equilibrium, no bias is applied. So there is no input of energy into the whole arrangement. But the diode is giving energy to the voltmeter. Okay? This is not possible. So you can't have energy out of a device without giving any energy into the diode. This is contrary to law of conservation of energy. So you cannot measure the built-in voltage. Please understand this. Okay? Then one may ask, what happens to this potential? Does it not come across this voltmeter? It does not, because moment you want to connect the voltmeter to the p-n junction, you are using metal wires here. Okay? So this is metal, this is also metal, which means you are connecting metal regions here. Now what is going to happen is that there is going to be a built-in potential between this metal and this n-type semiconductor, and this metal and this p-type semiconductor. Now these built-in voltages which are coming across these two metal semiconductor junctions will cancel the built-in voltage that is shown here for the p-n junction. And overall in the loop, you will get a zero voltage. So by Kirchhoff's law, no voltage will appear across the voltmeter, because these two voltages across these two Schottky contacts, because metal semiconductor contacts are called Schottky contacts. So these two metal semiconductor contacts will have built-in voltages which will together oppose this particular built-in voltage. And then you will get a zero current. Now another misconception students have is that whenever the applied voltage across the diode is more than the built-in voltage, then the current starts flowing. Because they think that when you forward bias the diode, then you are superimposing a voltage in this direction, which is opposite to this built-in electric field. So until and unless you remove this complete built-in electric field, no current can start flowing. Now this is absolutely wrong, because as we have seen, even when you apply a voltage that is very small compared to the built-in electric field, in fact that is a condition under which the ideal diode characteristics are derived, which is called the quasi-equilibrium condition. That is, equilibrium is disturbed only to a small extent. Under such conditions, the current starts flowing, okay? And in fact, you can never really totally cancel this built-in voltage. So whatever applied voltage is there, that, as we have said, that comes across the contacts, then across the P-region, then partly across this particular junction. So this is the voltage across the junction, that is, that we have called as VD. Then you have voltage drop across the N region, and you have voltage drop across the contact here. So if you go on increasing your voltage here, please note that VD will always remain less than psi naught. That is, if your V goes on increasing even beyond psi naught, what is going to happen is that the extra voltage beyond psi naught is going to drop here. And this voltage will always remain less than psi naught, but it will approach psi naught. Okay? So this is a very important point to understand. So built-in voltage can never be washed out by the externally applied voltage. And it is not that whenever the applied voltage is more than built-in voltage, the current starts flowing. Okay? So cut-in voltage is not the same as built-in voltage. Built-in voltage is a constant for a diode, whereas the cut-in voltage is a parameter that depends on the current levels which are being used for the diode in the applications. Cut-in voltage is a measurable voltage, whereas built-in voltage is not a measurable voltage. Okay? Now, having discussed these aspects, let us look at the characteristics again. You find that only in a small range here for the silicon diode, the characteristics follow the ideal law of I naught exponential V by Vt. In higher current ranges, that is here, as well as in lower current ranges here, the characteristics deviate significantly from this exponential V by Vt law. So in fact, for very low currents, it follows the exponential V by 2 times Vt law. And for very high currents, again, it becomes exponential V by 2 times Vt, and maybe even different from that later on. And similar things are observed also for the gallium arsenide diode. Okay, so here, lower current range, it is exponential V by 2 times Vt. And then again, at higher currents, there is a deviation. So we will now like to explain these deviations. That is our next exercise. Now, how do we explain the deviations from the ideal diode characteristics? Okay. Now, to arrive at these explanations, let us look at the characteristics again. You find that in the range where the characteristics are following exponential V by 2 times Vt law, that is in the low current range, the current is more than that predicted by the ideal diode law. Okay? So let us understand this. So if you sketch I on the log scale versus V, supposing the ideal diode law is going like this. This is, suppose, the exponential of V by Vt. Now, in the lower range, you are getting exponential of V by 2 times Vt. Clearly, you can see that at every point, every voltage, instead of this current predicted by the ideal diode law, you are predicting this current. Okay? So clearly, your current according to the exponential V by 2 times Vt law is more than the current predicted by the ideal diode law. So which means there is additional current flowing through the diode at low current levels, in addition to the currents that we have assumed for the ideal diode derivation, the currents we have assumed to derive the ideal diode characteristics. So what is this current? Now it can be shown that the additional current is because of recombination in the depletion layer. Please note that this current was neglected in our ideal diode analysis. We had assumed that when the currents flow across the depletion layer, there is no change in their magnitude, okay, the hole current as well as electron current. So this was the flow diagram that we have drawn. We have to add this current in the low current range. So this is generation recombination. In the depletion layer, this is additional current that flows at very low currents. Now, as the current levels increase, however, this current increases slowly as compared to this current. This is because of diffusion. These two currents are because of diffusion. Okay? So this can be seen again here. If you extend this line, it goes something like this. Whereas you extend the other line, which is corresponding to diffusion current, it goes like this. This is steeper. So in the beginning it is less, but after this point it is more. Okay, so this current takes over this current in this range. So diffusion current takes over for higher currents, whereas lower currents, the generation recombination current is dominating over the diffusion current. So which means that if you look at our approximations here, this is the approximation that is not working out at low currents. Okay, this particular approximation is the one that is getting violated at low currents. So we have to relax this approximation to predict the current at low current levels. Now, what about high current levels? Let us look at the characteristics at high currents here again. At high currents, the currents are lower than that predicted by the ideal diode law. Okay, so this is, currents are lower than this. So which means, if this is the way the ideal diode law goes, your actual current is going like this. So this current is lower. So why is the current lower for a given voltage than the ideal diode characteristics? The reason for this is that when the currents are higher, high injection levels are reached in this N region. That means this delta P becomes more than ND by 10, where ND by 10 is the doping in this region. ND is the doping in this region. So once this happens, when you have high injection level, it turns out that the current due to minority carriers flows not only because of diffusion, but also because of drift. So you have electric fields generated there, okay, when the injection levels are high. We will not discuss this point in greater detail as to why electric fields are generated, but you just take it that the electric fields are generated when the injection level is high, and therefore this means that there is a voltage drop here. So this voltage drop, which we have been neglecting, okay, becomes significant across the N region. Now, because of the voltage drop, there is a reduction in the amount of voltage that comes across the PN junction as compared to the applied voltage. So the entire applied voltage V is not coming across this junction here, because this voltage is there. Okay, so this can be also called the so-called series resistance effect. Okay, so it is because of this series resistance effect that your characteristics are showing the current is lower for any applied voltage V. The current is lower than you predict based on the ideal characteristics. So these deviations you can incorporate in the equation as follows. So a real diode equation will be I equal to I naught exponential of V minus IRS. This is a so-called series resistance because of the P and N regions. So V minus IRS is the voltage drop that comes across the junction. That is the VD by VT. And then you put an eta there to take into account presence of other currents. For example, the current in the generation recombination, the current in the depletion layer because of generation and recombination. That accounts, that is accounted for by this eta minus 1. So this is a real diode characteristic equation. RS is the series resistance, eta is so called ideality factor. For very low currents, this term is absent, eta is about 2. Okay. In general, for a current, eta lies between 1 and 2. So with this, we have explained the various features of the current voltage characteristics under forward bias. Now, we will discuss the energy band diagram under forward bias. How does it look like? To start with, let us look at the energy band diagram under equilibrium. This is what is shown here. Okay, so this is a diagram under equilibrium. Now, when you apply a forward bias, what is going to happen is this equilibrium depletion width, which is XD naught. The zero here or naught stands for equilibrium. This depletion width is going to shrink, and your potential drop across the depletion layer will reduce from Q psi naught to Q psi naught minus V, where V is this applied forward voltage. Okay, this is the voltage that is coming here. So if I were to draw the conduction band edge under forward bias, then it should look something like this. Okay? So where this difference is Q times psi naught minus V. Psi naught is in volts, we are writing Q times this because it is energy band diagram. Okay? So you are showing energies, electron volts. The depletion width has reduced. So this is the depletion edge on the P side, this is the P side, and this is the N side. And somewhere here you have the depletion edge on the N side, somewhere here. Okay, so this is the new depletion width under forward bias. So potential drop has reduced. Okay, and the depletion width also has reduced. Now, from here, we will draw the diagram under forward bias based on this information. So this is the depletion width under forward bias. This is XD. These show the depletion edges. And now you can see that since the conduction band edge on the inside has moved up by a voltage V, and far away from the depletion region, the conditions in the semiconductor are same as under equilibrium, the Fermi level in the far away region or the so-called neutral region where there are no excess carriers. Okay, so all the excess carriers are near the depletion edge here. The injected excess carriers are here. So beyond this, in this region, there are no excess carriers. Okay, so in that region, the Fermi level will also move up by V. Okay, because carrier concentration will be given by the difference between the conduction band edge and the Fermi level. So therefore, what we do is that we start drawing the energy band diagram under forward bias by assuming that the left hand side is same as under equilibrium, but the right hand side diagram has shifted up by a voltage V. And that is what you start with first. So the Fermi level on the n type is shown V volts above the Fermi level on the p side. Now this is the Fermi level called the quasi Fermi level. Under non-equilibrium conditions, you use the concept of quasi Fermi levels, which we have discussed. So this is EFP and this is EFN, quasi Fermi level on the n side. And the difference between these two, okay, levels, that is this difference, is Q times V, where the quasi Fermi level on the n side is shown above the quasi Fermi level on the p side. Okay, a simple way of remembering that the n side Fermi level will go up as compared to p side for forward bias is to note that forward bias polarity is this, which means n type is more negative. So on energy band diagram, where you show electronic energies going up, okay, the more negative regions will be shown with higher energies. That is why EFN is above EFP. Now, please note that what we have done here is we have drawn EFN and EFP in regions where there are no excess carriers. So this is the region near the depletion edge where you have excess carriers. So length of this region will be several times the diffusion length here of minority carriers. This, since this is p side, minority carrier diffusion length of electrons. So maybe let's say about 3 times ln, because you know that the carrier concentrations decay exponentially with distance. So over 3 times ln, the decay will be e power minus 3 times ln by 3, that is e power minus 3 times it will decay. So that means the excess carriers would have come down significantly. Okay. Similarly, this is the distance on the n side, which is 3 times LP. LP is the diffusion length of holes in the n side. So these are the regions where excess carriers are significant. Okay. In these regions, you have almost no excess carrier. So we first start with the energy band diagram in these regions. Now we can put the energy band diagram, other elements of energy band diagram here. So you put EC, you draw EC, and then you draw EV. So that is EV. Similar thing you can do on this side. This is EV, and this is EC. So now, how do we complete the picture? Now, what we do is we look at the assumptions one by one. First, we start with the assumption that there are no voltage drops in the P and N regions. So which means that the conduction band edge in the N region and in the P region should be shown flat. There is no variation in these conduction band edges. And also, of course, similarly, the valence band edges. So I can extend the EC here in this region because there is no voltage drop. And similarly, I extend EC here. Then extend EV parallel to EC. So we have completed the EC and EV in these regions. Now what about the quasi Fermi level? Okay, what do we do to the quasi Fermi level in this region? So now we invoke the assumption that the injection level in the P and N sides is low. Look at the table here. Okay, we have said that quasi-neutral region, the injection level is low. This is the assumption for deriving the current voltage characteristics, ideal current voltage characteristics. So since the injection level is low, it means that the majority carrier concentration is not disturbed. Okay, so the electron concentration on the N side is shown by the difference EC minus the quasi-Fermi level of electrons on this side, that is EFn. So this difference shows the majority carrier concentration. Since it is not disturbed even in this region where there are excess carriers, we can extend this EFn, okay, as a line even here, as a straight line. Same straight line is extended here, because the difference between these two should be approximately constant. Injection level is low, majority carrier concentration is not disturbed. We do the same thing for EFp on this side. Okay, because the difference between EFp and EV indicates the whole concentration on p side. Right. Now, how do we move into the depletion layer? Well, we know that depletion layer, we have to join EC as a continuous line, because the entire voltage is dropping there, and same thing we do to EV. So this difference is Q times psi naught minus V. What do we do to the quasi-Fermi level, EFn? We invoke the quasi-equilibrium approximation in the depletion layer. So this is this approximation, okay? Jn approximately equal to 0 and Jp approximately equal to 0. Now, if you look at the transport equation in terms of quasi-Fermi level, we have derived it earlier, one of the earlier lectures, then the Jn and Jp depend on the gradients of the quasi-Fermi level, including drift and diffusion, okay? So therefore, gradient of the quasi-Fermi level can be approximately assumed to be 0, which means the quasi-Fermi level is constant. This is the statement of quasi-equilibrium. So we extend this EFn in the depletion layer and EFp also in the depletion layer. So this is because of quasi-equilibrium assumption. Now thereafter, we can complete the diagram. The EFn will vary like this. Here there are no excess carriers, so EFn and EFp are same. Here the difference between EFn and EFp shows the presence of excess carriers. And similarly, you can do the same thing on the other side, where the EFp varies, okay? And here you have no excess carriers. So this is how the energy band diagram under forward bias is completed, okay? In the next lecture, we will see some information that we can get from the energy band diagram very easily as compared to the analysis which does not include the energy band diagram, that is from the five basic equations.